Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, depending on when you're watching this. Welcome to Rincon Congregational United Church of Christ, those of you in our sanctuary, and those of you watching online. This is our second hybrid worship service where we are both in person and online. We are figuring it out all together. Wherever you're joining us from, welcome. I've got 15-month-old batteries in here, so I am going to enunciate. Wherever you are in life's journey, also welcome. We want to make this safe space, and we claim a living God, a spirit among us at home, in the sanctuary, out in Tucson, and the world. We are based out of Tucson, Arizona. A living God who loves you unconditionally, whether LGBTQIA, all abilities, black, brown, white, or a bit of each, man, woman, or a bit of both, older, younger, bit of both, in person, at home, or a bit of both. Welcome. I'm not sure exactly what that would mean. That would be some creepy artificial intelligence. My name is Seth Wispelwood. I'm the interim pastor here at Rincon, and however you come today, it is a gift. I'm still giddy. I'm still emotional. We're still figuring things out, and we are getting there together. From tongues of fire on Pentecost last Sunday to burning coals on Trinity Sunday this Sunday, or whenever you're watching this. A couple important announcements. Next week, and I think everyone's going to applaud this, we are moving back to 10 a.m. services. So the live stream will be at 10 a.m. Arizona time, 1 p.m. Eastern. The reason is because we can. Our very careful diligence from our leadership and the ongoing vaccination rates and so on has determined that we can expand capacity in our sanctuary, but the more important reason from the feedback I've gotten is that people wanted more sleep, including me. This is a new thing to come back to. So 10 a.m. next Sunday, and sign up if you want to come. We can hold up to 50 people in our sanctuary, and we hope that number only expands. Beloved, it's so good to see you. Will you please stand in body or spirit as you're able for our call to worship?
Good morning, Rincon. Please join me in the responsive call to worship. Come, let us worship our God with joy and thanksgiving. Everything in us says,
thank you.
At worship in this sacred space, we say it again,
thank you.
For your love, for your faithfulness,
thank you.
When the earth's rulers hear what you have to say, O God, they'll sing of what you have done.
How great the glory of God.
Finish what you've started in us, God. Your love is eternal. Stay with us now that we may say,
thank you.
And please join us in hymn number 506, and it will be on the screen.
Oh, what a privilege to care
seated. Are you feeling weak and heavy laden? You say no, and I can believe you. I know what we've been through. We're about to take it to God in prayer for a moment of confession, which I also just like calling honesty. We sometimes aren't doing okay, or we may not have done as well as we would have liked in the week prior. And so this is hopefully a safe space to say inside ourselves and a little bit out loud, I'm not doing okay, God, or I haven't done okay, and reminding ourselves together, because God is in the together and in you, that God's got it, God gets it, and we are going to be okay. So, when we forget that God's ways lead all to the blessings of justice and mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
When we forget that God's ways lead all, especially the most vulnerable, to blessings of safety, health, and meaningful work.
Christ, have mercy.
When we forget that God's ways lead all to the blessings of the shared abundance of God's beloved creation.
Lord, have mercy.
Take a few moments in silence, prayer, and reflection. Jesus reminds us, who is my parent and who are my siblings? All those who do the will of God are my siblings and parent. In Christ, beloved, we are forgiven all our failed efforts at community and invited afresh to rejoin the family of God, seeking blessings for all. Amen to that good news. Now will you please rise again in body and spirit for some holy, holy, holy.
Holy, 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 God the Almighty.
scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Listen to and for the word of God. In that year, King Uzziah died. I saw the Lord sitting on the throne, high and lofty, and the hem of God's robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above God. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of God's glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a person of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth and with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
Living, loving, still speaking God, thank you for descending in us and among us as a warming, bright flame, a tongue of fire that gives us language to spread your good news, a burning coal that fires us up. Speak those languages. It's not always easy. In fact, it very rarely is, but together we will light up this world. In Jesus' name, amen. A few less wrinkles this week. If you're wondering, did I get a new tattoo? No, but this is a wrinkle connected to figuring out this new in-person worship service, which is that I don't get outtakes and do-overs and re-recordings and edits anymore. I drive to church, and like, did I write that in the sermon? Maybe I need a Sharpie on my hand to make sure I don't forget it. As I sat down to write this sermon on Friday morning, a wave of blankness and fatigue washed over me. I had been reading and researching this week's text in the days prior, getting fascinated about more of the history and context of Isaiah here in these verses than would ever fit into an entire lecture series. But as the week drew to a close and I opened my Word document on my computer, all I felt was, the last thing I want to do is this right now. Anything but this. I see a fellow pastor nodding. I even took to social media to procrastinate and articulate exactly that. And literally, right after I hit send on that tweet, bam! A sparrow banged hard into my office window. My heart and body literally jumped. Remember, I'm blank and fatigued. Now, this was odd, as my bird feeder out front is like 10 yards from the window. As I collected myself, I hear my daughter yelling out from her bedroom where she was reading, "Daddy, Daddy, there's a huge bird eating another bird outside the window." And sure enough, There on the power line was a massive red-tailed hawk with a mourning dove in its talons. The bird that hit my window, it was okay, was simply escaping with the rest of the survivors when the attack came. I whipped out my iPhone and started recording this chapter in the circle of life we usually only like to tolerate, if we do, on a nature program, as the majestic raptor began plucking feathers one by one from its meal above my fence line. 3 minutes into this most welcome procrastination, in swoops a mockingbird around the electrical pole. You've probably seen this before, a smaller bird, and mockingbirds are famous for this especially, antagonizing the much larger carnivorous predator in an attempt to get it to fly off. Fly off where? Away from whatever the smaller bird is wanting to protect. Chances are the mockingbird lives nearby and has a home, or maybe a nest to protect, and doesn't want the big, strong, dominant hunter nearby. Talk about bravery. Smaller birds, including crows, do this mobbing effect regularly against raptors. And ornithologists agree that while a hawk could easily take one of them down with their talons too, they typically just take off to get away from the harassment. 3 minutes later than this, that's what this red-tailed hawk did too. And a few minutes later than that, a flock of 10 more mourning doves was already back congregating comfortably under the feeder, picking up the manna, so to speak, dislodged and dropped by the sparrows and finches, the members and friends, if you will. I think in this analogy, I'm the Gila woodpecker. We'll find out. Now, while I love these apex avian predators, I mean, this thing is like this, and I love seeing one hanging out above my urban front yard, and fully appreciate the necessaries that order nature. For our purposes here today, I'm going to position Mrs. Mockingbird as our gateway to understanding the prophet. She wasn't at the feeder. She wasn't hanging out with the other birds. There aren't even any bushes nearby where a nest might have been. She was minding her mockingbird business when a hot coal of the spirit was touched to her tongue, or whatever's in there. Her response, "Here am I, send me." Send me. Now, if you're looking around your life, fired up about God's dreams for shalom, and beloved community, and God's burning hatred of injustice, and the machinations of man that oppress fellow divine image bearers, let's say the poor hapless doves. And if we're telling ourselves that we'll jump to when the coal comes, or if we're wondering what to do about our burning fall, I'm here to remind us that what's holding us back from putting it on the power line more proactively isn't a lack of clear opportunity and clarion calls, but blockages that diminish the vision of the circling seraphs in our time. We are led to dismiss the ones that they're sending, the mockingbirds, in prophetic roles as we understand them in our scriptural texts, because I think we all want to be the nest protectors. This is the nest, beloved. So let's understand the prophet more deeply. Who is Isaiah? Who are the prophets? What is a prophet? Well, for our context, as Rabbi Abraham Heschel puts it so excellently in his essential book, Heschel himself marched with King, Dr. Martin Luther King, constantly. His essential book, named The Prophets, he says, instead of dealing with the timeless issues of being and becoming, of matter and form, of definitions and demonstrations, the prophet is thrown into orations about widows and orphans, about the corruption of judges and affairs of the marketplace. Instead of showing us a way through the elegant mansions of the mind, the prophets take us to the slums. The world is a proud place, full of beauty, but the prophets are scandalized and rave in a way that makes us believe they think the whole world were a slum. Why such immoderate excitement? Why such intense indignation? The mourning dove isn't even the same species as the mockingbird. Get out of here, hawk. Why such a moderate excitement? Why such intense indignation? Well, in part because maybe we're too moderate. We aren't indignant enough. As Heschel continues, to us, a single act of injustice, cheating in business, exploitation of the poor, is slight. By to us, I'm going to say those who identify more comfortably in skin color, wealth, etc. To us, a single act of injustice is slight. To the prophets, a disaster. To us, injustice is injurious to the welfare of the people. To the prophets, it is a death blow to existence, an episode to us. To us, injustice is an episode, or maybe a news item. To them, a catastrophe, a threat to the world. Their breathless impatience with injustice may strike us as hysteria. If you don't believe me, read through some prophets in the Hebrew scriptures. It may strike us as hysteria. We ourselves witness continually acts of injustice, manifestations of hypocrisy, falsehood, outrage, misery. We're on social media. But we rarely grow as indignant or overly excited. For example, here's Jeremiah. Be appalled, O heavens, at this. Be shocked. Be utterly desolate, says the Lord, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed out, insult upon insult, cisterns for themselves, broken cisterns that can hold no water. Here's Heschel some more. Now, is not the vastness of the prophet's indignation and the vastness of God's anger in disproportion to its cause? How should one explain such moral and religious excitability, such seemingly extreme impetuosity? Impetuous, because remember, beloved, often prophets are working to make their words known to the most powerful they can find. They're seen as imps at best, and harassment at worst. They're seeking to make their words known to the most powerful they can find, the ones with leverage to hurt or heal en masse. Heschel goes on, the prophet's words are outbursts of violent emotions. I've been called passionate a few times in my life. I'm not saying I'm a prophet. Believe that. I mean, we can't rely. The prophet's words are outbursts of violent emotions. But remember our text and sermon from last week? It was a violent wind that blew through on Pentecost that brought the fire tongues, probably lit with embers too, The prophet's rebuke is harsh and relentless.
But,
and pay attention here, but if such deep sensitivity to evil is to be called hysterical, what name should be given to the abysmal indifference and moderate reforms we feel more comfortable voting for, which the prophet bewails?
Amen.
Here's Amos, another prophet. They drink wine in bowls, anoint themselves with the finest oils, but are not grieved over the ruin of Joseph. Feel free to substitute police violence or Palestine. Climate change. Our eyes are witness to the callousness and cruelty of man, Rabbi Heschel says, but our hearts try to obliterate the memories, to calm the nerves, and to silence our conscience. The prophet is a person who feels fiercely. God has thrust a call upon their soul, and they are bowed and stunned, tongue on fire. The agony of others, systemic injustice behind it, is frightful, and no human voice can convey the full terror. God loves us so much. God's love belongs to each person who is also in agony, preventable agony. Now, prophecy, this is all prophecy is. Prophecy is the voice that God has lent to the agony, a voice to the plundered poor, to the profaned riches of the world. This is a voice all of us can have. We don't have to be as hot and bothered on the page as Isaiah and Jeremiah and Amos. Prophecy is the voice that God has lent to the agony. Which means prophecy is a form of living and loving, a crossing point of God and human. God is raging in the prophet's words, but because God is so fiercely in love with everyone. Now, how are those words formed and told and heard? The prophet's style is, and I love this, poetic. The use of emotional and imaginative language, think abolish the police. It's concrete in diction. It's rhythmical in movement. It's artistic in form. But this poetry is not reflecting a state of inner harmony or poise. I love those poems too. But it's styled with agitation and anguish and a spirit of holy non-acceptance of the status quo. The prophet's concern is not with nature, but with history. How history is showing up now. And history, beloved, is devoid of poise, though critics of the 1619 Project would have us think otherwise. All right. Whew. Welcome back. If this all sounds intense, it's because it is. It's supposed to be. It's why we turn off and recoil from this kind of prophet to begin with. But look to the center of the heart here, and you will find the shared embrace we have. Because the prophet's theme is, first of all, and this is Heschel, the prophet's theme is, first of all, the very life of a whole people. And the prophet is identifying with people for far more than a moment or a news cycle. The very life of a whole people is the first concern here. We can get on board with that. What makes us uncomfortable is the prophet won't let us stop paying attention. The prophet practices what they preach, involved with the people in what is foreshadowed by their words. They're not just saying, this is what's going to happen to Israel. Peace out, King. They're in it, even if that destruction comes. And this is the secret of the prophet's style. The secret is their life and soul are at stake, embodied in solidarity. they say and what is going to happen? Are our lives and souls summarily at stake? Or are we so comfortable we can afford to ignore the clarion calls for justice in our midst? Sounds really good when we read it in Isaiah, like, oh yeah, that's motivating. It's alive now. Do we dismiss it as too overreaching? The hearers in 742 BC did the same, asking for too much too soon. History has no poise, beloved, but it does have a clear track record of who missed the boat when human rights were being fought for by the prophets in our midst. Creation care as well. This is true for our current moments. Do you want to be someone who lived through the now and missed the boat? I surely hope not. Let me be clear, though. Very few in the vast numbers of humanity are representative of these descriptions I've laid out by Rabbi Heschel. Most who are in line with these descriptions, think of the Dr. Kings, right? Finder of the Fred Hamptons, and so on. Most of them find their lives cut off too soon. Not everyone is called to be this kind of prophet. Let me be clear about that. But I also want to make an important distinction about two words that we too often define down in our attempts to separate and avoid having our lives and souls at stake in the way that we're still called to be by the prophets. Now, these words are prophetic and pastoral. Oftentimes, people separate them out and say, oh, well, I'm not called to that, or I'm called to this. To claim to walk in the way of Jesus is to make claims to being prophetic and pastoral. They are not mutually exclusive. They're actually symbiotic when we consider the way of the world. To be pastoral in the way Jesus did relationship and with whom he did relationship is to be prophetic. Because under the hawk-eye gaze of empire, hanging out and giving dignity and human worth and rights to those that the empire has very intentionally crushed underfoot is scandalous. It's also very pastoral. You're just feeding them and hanging out with them, but it's going to have a cost. And to be prophetic, in our context, calling things what they are with brave truth and embodied action is to be pastoral. Because it's showing up in love to those marginalized and oppressed most under empire. They see it as an act of love, hanging out where they are being crushed. It's risk-taking to us because we don't have to do it. It's showing up in love. To be prophetic in the way of Jesus is to be pastoral. To be pastoral in the way of Jesus is to be prophetic. So I reject the distinction between the two, like there's some job description or personality test or experience. We are all of us. Here's where it gets exciting. We are all of us invited by Jesus to repent and turn around to the kingdom of God at hand. I know this fire touches a lot of you, and I've seen that some of that fruit. So bring who you are and bring it to the way he modeled, and you will be an announcer of that kingdom, which will also bring, as our hymn reminded us, denouncing and forsaking from those threatened by the love and life you model. It's just what comes with, which just means you're doing something right. The priesthood of all believers that we profess means you, all of you, contain prophecy and pastoral care. They feed each other. Find your flame, however dimly it may be lit within you. Find ways to sustain it. We need to stay burning. We halls that already surround you, the prophets in our midst, and the seraphs and their coals. It will illuminate them for you, and we get to choose. Here's a final word from Rabbi Heschel. The prophet seldom tells a story, but casts context on events. They rarely sing, but castigate. The prophet does more than translate reality into a poetic key. They are a preacher whose purpose is not self-expression or the purging of emotions, but communication. The prophet's images must not shine, they must burn. The prophet's priorities, this is me, like Jesus's much later on, are the opposite of wealth, wisdom, and might. The highest goods, are the justice, mercy, and humility that God desires and demands. In a world on fire, with the violent outcomes of fetishizing wealth, wisdom, and might, we, beloved, you, are baptized with a new fire. We're called to harass the hawk of imperial violence. We're, most of us at Rincon, the sparrows and finches. Who, I should add, were hanging out watching the mockingbird do its thing. Mockingbird wants help. Our current moment, abolish the police, smash the patriarchy, turn swords into plowshares, dismantle white supremacy, give all you have to the poor. That one's an oldie but a goodie. Free Palestine. Tear down the border walls, no, literally. Take down this flag. This is live. This is an advertisement to those who I know would feel more welcome. And no one's explained in the name of Jesus yet to me why this is up here. But several folks came because of that original sermon. Whoever we want to come to this church, I know we say we want these banners to be our advertisement. Or do we want young families? Invest in it. Is the fire actually burning for these things? If it's not, it's okay. But where is the burning? If we want a robust music program, invest in it. God's economy is the opposite of the world's. So our choices in God's house must be done according to the light of an entirely different worldview. Not the standards of Tucson's cost of living or anything. This is live on the internet. We have $400,000. Jesus Christ, that's amazing. Transformational. It could light something up. And I know this fire is in so many individuals. What it needs to light up is the fusion. The flame. One stick can start a bonfire. Do these phrases and sentences sound too overreaching? Too much too soon? There is room in life and light for everybody, but what change are we afraid of when there is agony for welcoming and belonging? I'm not making a big deal about the flag, but if the flag is a big deal, if it's a barrier to people feeling belonging, which is more important, who cares? Right? We don't even have to understand why it might need to come down. I'm not losing sleep over this, but I want people to feel embraced here, and that needs to be our center. Whether we're dancing on the coals, agitated, or more, and this is just as important, if not more so, the ones ready to give a hug to the young, home insecure, queer youth who has never been affirmed in the name of God. sees the flag of empire next to the cross and is like, WTF. Okay, I'm off script. Is this hyperbole? It depends on how close the flaming coal is. Let's not diminish and dismiss the flames. There are fires burning here. I pointed them out last week. You get some yin and yang with me. Let's expand and embrace the light. You are mockingbirds and sparrows and finches. You can be. Age and experience and knowledge are no barriers to this calling. The seraphs are calling. Justice is crying out. Isaiah said, here am I. Send me. Here you are. Weeks ahead out there. You don't have to be masked according to the CDC, but you know, treat each other comfortably and respectfully with whatever level of comfort you have. So I will see you all at 11 o'clock on Zoom for those who join, and we will be reflecting on just kind of tying off these unprecedented 15 months. It's not over yet, but we're going to reflect on what all this Zooming and screen time has meant and how we've stayed connected. I think it'll be a beautiful conversation and more. Okay, I left the benediction over there. Finish what you started in us, O God. Your love is eternal. Go with us now into the world, that we may say, thank you.
Gracias.
Peace be with you, and with justice comes peace. Let us build peace together and
change our world.
Change our world. Amen. Stick around for our postlude if you'd like. God bless you.